Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I formally declare open the 11th of February 2021 Ordinary Meeting of Council, and in so doing, I welcome you all here tonight to this live stream meeting. I acknowledge the Whadjuk people of the Noongar Nation, who are the traditional custodians of the land in which we are gathered, and I pay respect to their elders past, present and emerging, and extend that respect to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people who may be with us tonight, either in person or viewing online. Given the COVID-19 pandemic, it is still with us, there continues to be a need for physical distancing and following the hygiene requirements, i.e. hand washing, etc. Accordingly, sitting in the council chamber in the public gallery has been set out to ensure physical distancing requirements are met. I ask that you follow the physical distancing requirements during the meeting and particularly when leaving the meeting. Also, please note in regard to tonight's meeting, this council meeting will be electronically recorded and live streamed on the city's website, except where council resolves to go behind closed doors. All recordings are retained in accordance with the General Disposal Authority for Local Government Records produced by the State Records Office. A copy of the recorded proceedings and a transcript of the whole council meeting will be available on the website within 2 business days of the council meeting. This will be easy to find from the front page of the city's website. Images of the public gallery are not included in the webcast. However, the voices of people will be captured and streamed. I would therefore remind everyone present to be mindful of their conduct as it will be recorded. This is a council initiative aimed at increasing our transparency and openness, as well as making council meetings more accessible to our community and those beyond. The elected members will be voting on agenda items by using the electronic system that will display the vote of each member and allow them to be recorded in the minutes of each meeting. Before moving to the agenda proper, I advise the following. Firstly, on behalf of Council, I welcome Mr. Tony Bruin, the City's newly appointed Chief Executive Officer, to his first ordinary meeting of Council. Mr. Bruin commenced with the City on Monday, the 1st of February 2021, at the same time as the lockdown was announced. So I think it'll be a time that will be remembered by many people. Referring to Australia Day, the City conducted a very successful Coogee Beach Festival on Australia Day, followed by a citizenship ceremony and a presentation of the Community Citizens of the Year Awards to local citizens in recognition of active citizenship and outstanding contribution to the community. The recipients of these awards were, firstly, in the Community Citizens of the Year Youth category, Lane Dixon. In regard to the Community Citizens of the Year Senior category, Jean Bruce. In regard to the Community Citizens of the Year Award, Dan Robertson and Louise Keep. And the Active Citizenship Group or event was awarded to the Coburn Chinese Community Association. Some of you may know that this year the local government in Western Australia celebrates its 150th anniversary. 2021 represents the 150th anniversary, as I said, of local government in Western Australia. While those early days saw local governments focus on roads, rubbish and rates, the sector has grown over time to provide a much wider range of services to their respective communities. Checking the honour board outside earlier today, I acknowledge the contributions of over 270 elected members who have served our community since 1871 and the staff who continue to provide an increasingly complex and diverse range of services to our community, supported by an amazing number of volunteers. All of us will be aware of the Wooraloo bushfires and others across the state. And I take this opportunity on behalf of Council to thank the Defence Career Fireys, the Volunteer Bushfire Brigades, the State Emergency Service volunteers and other volunteers who provided support, and of course all other local governments involved in the bushfires over the recent months, the not-for-profit sector and the business community for their efforts during the recent, as I said, Wooraloo bushfires and other bushfires that have occurred. And many small bushfires happen within the city of Cockburn, and some of those are deemed to be deliberately lit, and of course that is concern for everybody. Also like to reflect on the Carnarvon floods, and our thoughts are with the communities and the particular local governments at this time as they are impacted by the tropical low that's caused widespread flooding and closed parts of the Northwest Coastal Highway and seen severe damage, and we're currently closed until Main Roads WA commence the necessary repair work in conjunction with the relevant local governments. The annual general electors meeting, initially scheduled for Tuesday the 2nd of February 2021, needed to be rescheduled given the COVID-19 pandemic lockdown announced by Premier McGowan on Sunday the 31st of January 2021. The annual general electors meeting is now scheduled for Wednesday the 24th of February 2021, commencing at 7 p.m. in council chambers. And the lockdown that's occurred, as I mentioned earlier, and again on behalf of council, I acknowledge and thank the staff in the City of Cockburn for their seamless transition to the lockdown announced by the Premier, and for the continuing need to manage service delivery in a changed world. It was a very seamless transition to working from home for the majority of staff. And again, we've been through this before, so it's well drilled and understood that when things do happen, we have to, like other local governments in Western Australia, respond to the direction of the state government itself. So thank you and stay safe. I'll now proceed to the agenda proper. Agenda item 3 is a disclaimer, which I will now read. Members of the public who attend council meetings should not act immediately on anything they hear at the meetings without first seeking clarification of council's position. Persons are advised to wait for written advice from the council prior to taking action on any matter that they may have before council. Agenda item 4, which is the acknowledgement of receipt of written declarations of financial interests and conflicts of interest. We have 4 that have been submitted today in writing. I'm just asking elected members now, are there any other declarations that need to be made at this point in time? If not, those particular declarations I mentioned earlier, the 4, will be made at the appropriate time of the agenda. Agenda 5, which is apologies and leave of absence. We have an apology from Councillor Leanne Smith, OAM. Agenda item 6, which is written request for leave of absence, which is nil. Agenda item 7, response to previous public questions taken on notice, is nil. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we move to agenda item 8, which is public question time. The city has received 1 written question relating to tonight's agenda, and it's also received a number of questions relating to in writing of non-agenda items. So I'll just remind everyone here that you'll need to come forward when you're called through here carefully to the lectern that's there, and then you'll be required to ask your question or questions. Public question time is not a period for making statements. If you have a question, you should have that with you. If you haven't, raise your hand at the time and you'll have a copy of that provided to you. So we'll now move to the public question time. So the first agenda item relates to agenda item 17.1, Dixon Park, Wally Hagen Recreation Centre redevelopment. And I'll call forward Jacina De Rutilia, is it? Thank you. Again, and if you could state your full name and your suburb where you reside, and then also then ask your question or questions. Thank you.
My name is Josina Draiter from Hamilton Hill. Regarding 17.1, Dixon Park and Wally Hagen Recreation Centre development. Dear Mayor, councillors and staff, I'm a member of the Pinakari community in Hamilton Hill and have advocated for sensitive, sustainable and connected development in Dixon Precinct over the last 5 years. Tonight before Council is the proposal to adopt option 3 as the new preferred option. I noticed that in the proposal, on page 193-194, the Council decision is set out, outlining 6 points of the decision Council adopted regarding this area on October 2018. However, point 7 is missing. This point was added after me and several other community groups, as well as local residents, called on the Council for years to be included in the design process of this redevelopment planned for Dixon Reserve. Point 7 states, ensures that full consultation and engagement is undertaken with local affected residents and stakeholders regarding concerns raised in relation to social, cultural, and environmental components of the Dixon Park proposals in advance of any associated development being undertaken. Therefore, I like to remind Council of this commitment. This point was added because local groups, stakeholders, and residents did not feel there had been sufficient consultation. Current plans were drawn up informed only by sports and recreation data on stakeholders, nor was it the planned development and buildings designed in a sustainable manner or in a way that would connect the buildings to its environment and be sensitive to the significant heritage area it is situated in. I ask that the Council include the same commitment as part of this decision, additional to the recommendation in the officer report. This will provide the community that the Council remains committed to engaging with local stakeholders as this process progresses and lives up to its own strategic policy to be a leader in environmental management and to support an inclusive and connected community, as per page 196, para 1. With real community input and sensitivity.
Thank you. I think that's the question that you've submitted, so we need to stop there. Thank you for that. And I'll ask Mr. Green to respond. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. The point made by the person asking the question is contained on page 197 of the agenda, and I quote, should section 18 approval be received, more consultation would then occur during the next phases of the design with the broader community. So it's clearly the commitment of Council to do that, and it still is a valid part of the decision made in 2018 that is still obviously in effect. Thank you, Your Worship.
Thank you, Mr. Green. Thank you for your question.
Thank you.
The other questions that we've received in writing relate to non-agenda items. So the first person I will call forward is Sally Newsom, Coogee Beach Caravan Park. Could you please come forward? Thank you. Again, state your full name, the suburb where you live, and then ask your questions. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Sally Ann Newsom, I live at Coogee Beach. And my questions are about the caravan park. So as residents of the Coogee Beach Caravan Park, we would like to know how the Council feels about the terrible impact on the lives, mental health and financial well-being of the 40 households impacted by the proposed Discovery development. Should councillors be concerned about this aged and vulnerable community and oppose the signing of the extension to the City of Cockburn's lease with Discovery Parks?
Thank you, Mr. Arndt, thank you.
Through the Chair, in response to the question, the Council has yet to make any decisions on a new lease for the Coogee Beach Caravan Park, and as such, will not make any determination until such a time as a report is tabled for its consideration containing all the relevant facts and details.
Thank you, Mr. Arndt. And your next question, please.
My next question is, as residents of the Coogee Beach Caravan Park, we would like to know how the Council feels about the fact that despite City of Cockburn's press release on the 6th of February stating it should be clearly noted that Discovery Park's correspondence does not state anywhere that any lease will be terminated. And despite that, 40 long-term residents 3 days later on the 9th of February received a letter from Discovery Parks advising, prior to any development, Discovery would give residents notice on their tenancy agreement. The required notice period is 180 days, which will give residents 6 months' notice on the conclusion of their lease agreement. If the development proceeds, leases will be terminated. Should councillors be concerned that Discovery Parks are acting outside the City of Cockburn's understanding of events?
Thank you, Mr. Hunt. Thank you.
Through the chair, it's clear that from the current correspondence from Discovery Park that no current leases are being terminated at this time, which is what council has actually pointed out. What Discovery have clearly indicated is that if the development proceeds, and that is something that council would still have to consider, they are required to give 180 days notice, which is what they've specified in their correspondence.
Thank you, Mr. Hunt, for that. Thank you for your questions.
I've got one more, but it was later, so do I come back again? It was said I could ask it.
We're aware of that, Mr. Hunt. A further question?
Through the chair, I'm not aware of any further questions, but we do actually have a number of questions that have been submitted in writing, none of which, as I said, I can recall seeing a question from Sally Newson apart from the two that asked tonight.
Oh, I did get the email saying thank you for my third question.
Okay, well, please ask a question. Okay. Thank you.
Is the council aware Discovery Parks wrote on 9 February to 40 long-term residents at Coogee Beach Caravan Park, many of whom are elderly or unwell, refusing to honour their obligations under our periodic tenancy agreements to pay for all tenants' expenses resulting from any repositioning of the relocatable home, including reconnecting to services, paving, landscaping and any such costs?
Thank you for that, Mr. Arndt. Thank you.
Through the chair, the City has received a copy of Discovery Park's correspondence. And the correspondence for Discovery Park states, and I quote, "We can confirm that land on the western beach front of the property is earmarked for development. Unfortunately, this includes the land you currently lease from Discovery Parks. Around 35 of our tenants will be impacted. Without a lease extension, a final development plan and development approval, we don't know when we will be providing formal notice to you. Our best estimate is this will be in early 2022. We will be communicating with you through every step of the process, giving you as much time as possible to find new land to relocate your transport or residence to. We understand that this news will have a significant impact on you. Where possible, we will be working with residents to find alternative accommodation within our network, although this option is not guaranteed."
Thank you, Mr. Hunt. Thank you for your questions.
Can I just read the other part of what he said? He said...
I think we've got a whole list of questions by other people, right, and we haven't got that, but thank you for bringing those questions to our attention. Thank you. Can I just remind councillors that you should be wearing your face mask? Thank you very much. I'm sorry, councillor... Yes. I'm saying asking Councillor Siparich and Councillor Allen. No, thank you very much. I'm asking you to put on your face mask or leave the council chamber. Thank you. Your choice. Thank you. I'm asking and advising you that you should have your face mask on. If you do not wish to put on your face mask, please leave the council chamber.
And
thank you.
The state government has advised us,
yes,
there is an exception for being engaged in teaching, lecturing or broadcasting work.
Thank you.
We are broadcasting.
Thank you, Councillor Parrish. You received an email from the CEO earlier today advising all elected members, if you had some concern, you should have raised it then. So, again, either put your face mask on or leave the council chamber. Thank you. Same rules apply to everybody that's in this council chamber. Thank you. Very good. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll continue with public question time. I now ask Jill Sprout, is it, to come forward?
Right.
Thank you. Again, please state your full name, your suburb location, and ask your questions. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for in letting us all come here today. Only some could come. Okay, my name is Gillian Hannah Sproit, and I'm at Coogee Caravan Park, Coogee. Shall I read my question?
Yes, please.
Okay, thank you. Will the council agree to City and Discovery signing a new lease if the residents impacted in, and it is 41 houses, are not to be compensated and not given financial help and a suitable place to be relocated to, as stipulated in the current periodic lease that we all have that says that? Mr. Wilkins did say under the terms of your periodic leases, we have no obligations to pay compensation or relocation costs. Question number one.
Thank you very much for that question. Mr. Arndt, thank you.
Through the chair, first point of clarification is the city is not actually party to any of the periodic rental agreements that Discovery has with individual leaseholders and therefore cannot make any comment about those lease agreements. However, in respect to the second point, as I previously reiterated, Council has yet to make any decision in respect to a new lease and will only do so when a report on the matter is tabled before it, containing all the relevant facts and details.
Thank you, Mr. Arndt. We don't have recorded any other questions from you.
No, that's fine.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. I'll now ask for Dennis Vaughan to come forward, please. Dennis Vaughan? Not here. We'll provide an answer in writing to Dennis Vaughan following this council meeting. Neil Smith, please. And if you could state your full name, your suburb location, and ask your question. Thank you.
My full name is Neil Sheridan Smith. I'm a resident at Coogee Beach Caravan Park. My question is, I am asking the three West Ward councillors to move a resolution to incorporate in the proposed Discovery Park's lease a guarantee for the tenancy on their present sites of existing residents of Coogee Beach Caravan Park, or otherwise vote to refuse the application for a new lease.
Thank you for that. Mr. Arndt, thank you.
Through the chair, elected members are unable to make a predetermined outcome on a new lease and will be only in a position to make a decision when a report on the matter is tabled before it, containing all the relevant facts and details.
Thank you, Mr. Arndt.
This is not a request for a decision on the outcome. It's a request for three ward members to move a resolution that the tenants' rights be included in the proposed new lease.
Thank you very much. We understand that very much. Thank you for your question. Now call forward Karen Clicker, please. Thank you. Again, if you could state your full name, suburb, and ask your questions. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Karen Clicker. I reside at 81 Coogee Beach Holiday Park. And my question is, has the City of Corbin made sure that there are no alternative sites within the Coogee Beach Caravan Park for Discovery Park to build their cabins for tourism?
Thank you, Mr. Arndt.
Through the chair, the City has yet to formally receive or consider any proposals for the redevelopment of the Caravan Park from Discovery Parks. Any redevelopment proposals will need to examine all options for enhancing the park as short-term tourist accommodation.
Thank you, Mr. Hunt. And your next question, please.
Has the City of Corbin checked that we would need a fourth children's playground within, actually, the Coogee Beach Caravan Park, as we have three already?
Thank you. And Mr. Hunt?
As I previously indicated, the City has yet to receive or consider any redevelopment plans for the caravan park, so we are unable to comment on what facilities are being proposed for the park or whether they are required.
Thank you, Mr. Hunt. Thank you for your questions. Thank you. Is Anthony Satoma here, please? Again, state your full name, your suburb, and then your questions. Thank you.
My name is Anthony Joseph Satoma, and I live in Coogee. My question is, anecdotal evidence and personal experience suggests that there has been a significant increase in ranger visitations and patrols of the ammunition jetty beach area since 21st of October 2020, when it became designated as a prohibited dog beach. How many infringement notices have been issued to dog owners from the 21st of October 2020 to the 31st of January 2021 for having their dog on the beach during this period?
Thank you. Mr. Green?
Thank you, Your Worship. Only verbal interactions took place between 21 October 2020 and 23 November 2020, and no infringements were issued during that period. From 23 November 2020 to 31 January 2021, there were three written cautions and 20 infringements issued. Thank you, Your Worship.
Thank you, Mr. Green. And your next question, please.
Can the Council provide details on the total number of pooch pouch stations currently provided throughout the city as at the 1st of January 2021 and the primary areas where they are located? How many additional pooch pouch stations are planned for this calendar year?
Thank you. Mr. Green?
Through the Chair, the City currently has 214 dog pooch cylinders. They are primarily located at dog off-leash parks, sporting reserves, regional parks and neighbourhood parks. The City installs approximately 30 new dog pouch cylinders each year.
Thank you, Mr. Lees. Thank you for the questions. Now call forward Dr. Joanne Curry, please, or Curry. Again, if you could state your full name, your suburb, and ask your questions. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Dr. Joanne Marie Curry, and I'm a resident of Coogee. My question is, has the Council investigated the impact the proposed new ammunition jetty will have on the nesting environment of the fairy terns along Coogee Beach? And if so, how or where can this information be accessed?
Thank you, Mr. Lees. Thank you.
Through the Chair. The Department of Transport is the managing authority of the ammunition jetty. The Department of Transport is currently in the early stages of planning. The department is currently seeking input from a range of stakeholders, including the City of Coburn. The City has been advised all the required studies will be undertaken to identify, prevent and mitigate any environmental impacts due to the construction of a new jetty or a refurbished old jetty. Approvals would also need to be sought from various state and federal agencies, including the Environmental Protection Authority of WA.
Thank you for that response. Thank you for your question. Moving through to the next question, a call forward John Johnson, please. John Johnson, not here, will provide a written response. Thank you. And ladies and gentlemen, that brings us to the conclusion of questions that have been submitted in writing. We'll now move through to ask if anyone wishes to ask a question on an agenda item for tonight's meeting. Yes, please come forward, lady at the back there, thank you. And again, if you could state your full name, your suburb, and then ask your question or questions. Thank you.
My name is Michelle Abbott de Rivera, and I reside in Coogee. My question is in relation to also Coogee Beach Caravan Park. On the 10th of December at our meeting, Mr. Arndt was present and advised us all that was still not aware of the proposal with Discovery Park and what the plans were, whereas on the business plan that's just been uploaded on the 6th of February on the City of Coburn's website, it clearly states on page 4, which is underneath that lovely big picture, on the second paragraph, a request for proposal for the park was publicly advertised on the 15th of September 2018. The proposal submitted by Discovery Holiday Parks Proprietary Limited, DP, was determined to be the most satisfactory proposal received. Discovery Parks were advised on the 15th of May 2019 that their proposal was preferred subject to satisfactory public advertising in accordance with Section 3.59 of the Local Government Act 1995 and Council Determination. My question is, the City of Coburn was aware, as per the business plan, of what Discovery Parks was proposing and why we were told on a number of occasions at that meeting that the City of Coburn had no idea what the plans were going to be.
Thank you. Get Mr. Arndt to respond to that. Thank you.
Firstly, I didn't actually attend a meeting in December. I actually attended a meeting in January with the residents. Secondly, it is correct that Discovery Parks have not lodged any redevelopment proposals. What we talk about in terms of the business case is that we went out for expressions of interest on a national basis for caravan park operators to actually be able to demonstrate to the council their ability to not only manage and run a caravan park for short-term tourist accommodation, which is what the site is actually designated for, but also their capabilities in terms of financial capabilities of being able to actually invest into upgrading the actual caravan park, and an indication of what sort of sums of money that they would be actually looking at in terms of investing. There was no redevelopment plan formally lodged as part of their tender proposal, and at this stage they still have not yet lodged a formal plan. I understand that they are actually working on a plan, but there is no formal plan, so my comments are correct.
Thank you, Mr. Arndt.
And I have a second question, if I may.
Yes, please.
Thank you. In relation to that, may I ask what the business plan, which is uploaded on the 6th of February on the City of Coburn's website in relation to Coogee Beach Holiday Park, what that actually is for then, if that's not advising what the plans are?
Thank you, Mr. Arndt.
Through the chair, the business plan is actually required to actually be lodged and advertised because it is considered to be a major, or entering into the new lease is considered to be a major land transaction under the Act. The business case clearly sets out the overall financials in terms of what the expectations the city has of Discovery Parks in respect to redevelopment. And when I'm talking about redevelopment, it's talking about investment. The business case actually clearly states that part of the requirements would be that Discovery Parks is required to actually lodge a plan or demonstrate to the city their vision and what they are proposing to actually do in terms of redevelopment. As I indicated before, Discovery Parks are currently working on that, and that they will lodge that with the city in due course.
Thank you, Mr. Arndt. Thank you for your questions. I'll just ask again, is anyone wishing to ask a question on an agenda item for tonight's meeting? A non-agenda item? If not, thank you very much for your attendance and participation in the public question time period. And we do, the council does acknowledge the stresses that are on the people who have leases at the Coogee Beach Caravan Park. And we thank you for being here tonight. Moving through the agenda, I'll just wait. And just as you're leaving, make sure you maintain COVID distancing and keep your masks on. Thank you very much indeed. Stay safe. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We'll get back to the agenda. Agenda item 9, which is a confirmation of the minutes of the Ordinary Council meeting held on the 10th of December 2020. Can we have someone move to a true and accurate record? Councillor Stone, thank you. Councillor Allen, thank you. Any discussion or debate? If not, I'll put that. We'll go to the voting button, please. Ladies and gentlemen, we're just waiting for the electronic voting system to come up to be displayed for elected members to vote. Thank you. I declare that carried unanimously. Thank you. Moving through to agenda item 10, which is deputations, which there are nil. Agenda item 11, business left over from previous meeting, if adjourned, is nil. Agenda item 12, declarations by members have not given due consideration to matters contained in the business paper presented before the meeting. Are there any such declarations to be made? No, thank you. Moving through to those matters that will be carried in block, and I'll ask Mr. Brune to read out those items that are intended to be carried in block, and then opportunity for elected members to remove those items if they wish. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just finding the new system. The items to be carried on block are items 14.2, 15.1, 16.1, 18.1, 19.1, 22.1, 19.2 and 22.2.
Thank you, Mr. Brune. Are there any elected members who wish to withdraw an item, agenda item? If not, we'll have someone move for those particular items to be carried in block. Councillor Allen, thank you. Seconded, Councillor Eva. I'll now put that for the voting button to be reinstated there, please. I declare that carried unanimously. Thank you. Moving through to agenda item 13.1, which is required to be carried by an absolute majority. Can we have someone move that way, please? Which is the 2021 local government elections. Councillor Stone, thank you. Deputy Mayor Kirkwood. Any discussion, debate? If not, call for the voting button, please. declare that carried unanimously. Thank you. Moving through to agenda item 13.2, proposed amendment to the City of Cockburn Parking and Parking Facilities Local Law 2007 to be carried by an absolute majority. Do you have someone move that way, please? Councillor Allen, second to Councillor Cork. I will now ask for the voting buttons, please. 13.2. Declare that carried 8-1. Thank you. Moving through to agenda item 14.1. Deputy Mayor, I think we're going to move this item. Planning and Development Divisions, 14.1.
That Council 1, adopt the updated schedule of submissions attached, prepared in the respects to the proposed structure plan, and 2, adopt recommendations 2-4 as recommended.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Kirkwood. Do we have a seconder for that, please? Councillor Eva, thank you. And Deputy Mayor, the reason for the decision, thank you.
A number of submissions were inadvertently not included in the schedule of submissions included on the agenda. The schedule of submissions has been updated to include all submissions received, and Council will need to adopt the amended schedule of submissions.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Kirkwood. Is there any discussion, debate, anyone wishing to speak against this item? If not, we'll ask for the voting button to be displayed. Thank you. Declare that carried unanimously. Thank you. Moving through the agenda, agenda item 15.2 requires an absolute majority, statement of financial activity and associated reports, November and December 2020. Whoever mover, please, for that? Councillor Cork, thank you. Seconded, Councillor Eva. Is there any discussion or debate on this matter? If not, we'll call for the voting button, please. Declare that carried unanimously. Thank you. Moving through to agenda item 15.3, the mid-year budget review 2020-2021, going to be carried by an absolute majority. Do we have a mover for that, please? Councillor Stone, thank you. Seconded. Councillor Allen, thank you. Any discussion or debate on this matter? If not, we'll ask for the voting button, please. Declare that carried unanimously. Thank you. Moving through the agenda. To agenda item 17.1. We have an alternative from Councillor Weidenbach, but we do have a declaration from... Have I missed... 15-2. Oh, did I miss 15-2?
15-2. I've done them.
Sorry, I'm out of leave. It's always a challenge to keep up with all the different things happening. So we have an alternative from Councillor Weidenbach. We have a declaration from Councillor Cork, which... I shall now read. And this is addressed to the Chief Executive Officer to do with this particular agenda item, which is the Dixon Park and Wally Hagen Recreation Centre redevelopment. The nature of the interest is an impartiality interest pursuant to Regulation 11 Local Government in brackets Rules of Conduct, close of brackets, Regulation 2007, and the nature of the interest being, in my ongoing role as chair of the Hamilton Hill Community Group. I was involved in the Aboriginal Hamilton Hill Swamp Precinct and in the initial consultation process for the proposed Hamilton Hill Centre, which included Dixon Reserve as a possible location, and signed Councillor Cork. Thank you. Councillor Weidenbach.
Yes, I'd like to move an alternative that Council, one, adopt 1 through 4 as recommended, and two, adopt the following sub-recommendation number 5. 5, advise the Department of Planning, Lands and Heritage of the historical reports on the environmental setting of Dixon Park and the surrounding area, including the significant site investigations carried out in the area, and recommends that the reports be incorporated into the Section 18 application and subsequent report referred to in recommendation 4 above.
Thank you, Councillor Weidenbach. Do we have a seconder for that, please? Deputy Mayor Kirkwood, thank you. And Councillor Weidenbach, the reason, thank you.
Yeah, the reason, there has been significant study at considerable cost undertaken on Dixon Park area, which has not been included in this item. It is considered for Council, appropriate for Council, to recommend that the DPLH assess the site as a whole, including the environmental history, when preparing the Section 18 report.
Thank you, Councillor Weidenbach. Is anyone wishing to speak against the alternative? Councillor Cork first and then Councillor Stone. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. Through the Chair, Section 18 applications and reports are entirely in reference to Aboriginal heritage under the Act, and environmental history is irrelevant to such applications. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Cork. And someone wishing to speak for? No? If not, the opportunity, Councillor Weidenbach, for you to close. Thank you. Councillor Stone, sorry. A question?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Through the Chair, I noticed that both of these recommendations, the officer's recommendation and the alternative, endorsed design option 3, which was attachment 2, as the council's preferred option to undertake the Dixon Park Wally Hagen Recreation Centre redevelopment. My question is, wouldn't it be timely to actually revisit completely this particular proposal and the design, because the scope has changed, because there's more new information that's come to light, and I think it really needs to, the whole design needs to a rethink again. I think we need to go back to the drawing board, new information's come to light. So is it possible that that could happen, that we could actually go back to the initial drawing board, given this new information, and actually look at if there's an alternative design that could better fit this development?
Thank you, Councillor Stone. Mr. Green, is it? Thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. Well, obviously the recommendation is attached somewhat to the recommendation that was made back in 2018, and I would suggest it on that basis, but I'd have to get clarification on that. That it would require the council's 2018 decision be partly rescinded, so that there was no option then left on the table. Because at the moment we're talking about a previous recommendation or a previous council decision that had a preference for option 1, with option 3 as its second preference. So that would have to be, in my view, that would have to be withdrawn entirely. And the only way that that could be done would be for that whole decision or that part of the decision to be revoked. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Green. Any further questions? Councillor Tablanche, thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. Through the Chair to Mr. Green, if he could advise potentially how voting on this tonight could influence what Councillor Stone is trying to or asked about. So in other words, if we were to vote for Councillor Weidenbach's alternative recommendation, how or would it be possible afterwards to then go and revisit the plans as per Councillor Stone's question? And second to that, if his alternative does not go through, if the officer's recommendation go through, again, the same question on would Councillor Stone's suggestion be achievable?
Thank you, Councillor de Blanche. Mr Green, thank you.
Yes, thank you, Your Worship. Well, obviously, the current recommendation or the officer's recommendation is contingent on 3 and 4, which relate to the Section 18 application. And depending upon the feedback from that or the result of that application, that would determine where the city goes next with its alternatives from that point. So you know, without knowing any of that, obviously won't progress anywhere, it won't progress any further, and it's likely to take the best part of the rest of this year, I'm told, for the Section 18 application to be considered and the report received back from Council, from the department, I should say. So at that stage, the city officers would then be in a position to obviously revisit the matter and send and report back to Council. And at that point in time, Council would need to make a determination on where it wishes to go. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Green. Councillor Stone and then Councillor Cork. Thank you.
Thank you. Through the Chair, to the Director of Governance, is it possible to put up an alternative to rescind the motion from 2018 tonight that endorsed the development for Dixon Park and Wally Hagen and prepare a new and have a new prepare be designed?
Thank you, Councillor Stone. Mr Green, thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. No, that requires, obviously, four councillors to be able to sign a revocation notice, and then obviously that matter would then have to be put to Council and carried by an absolute majority. So I wouldn't imagine, well, that obviously can't happen at this meeting right now. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Green. Councillor Cork, you have a question?
Yes, thank you, Your Worship. Through the Chair to Mr Green. Two parts. The first part is, am I right in thinking that the funding for option 3 is not yet, we don't have the funding for it at this point?
Thank you, Councillor Cork. Mr Green.
Thank you, Your Worship. That is correct. There is nothing specifically allocated at this point in time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Green.
Thank you, Your Worship. Just following up on that, am I also right in thinking that depending on the outcomes of Section 18, the entire design may in fact be revisited anyway? Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Cork. Mr Green, thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. Exactly right. And that was the point of my earlier comment, that dependent upon that outcome will determine where the next stage or the next step in this exercise would go. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Green. Any further questions, Councillor Stone?
No, I'd just like to foreshadow an alternative.
Thank you. So we've got a mover and seconder. Is anyone wish to speak against? We've got Councillor Cork down here speaking against. Yes. Anyone for the alternative? If not, the opportunity for Councillor Weidenbauer to close. Thank you.
Thank you. So the HHSPAEEHS Heritage Study has identified a large portion of Dixon Park and the adjoining area as an area of significance, recommending that an area is registered as a significant site under the Aboriginal Heritage Act. What I'm proposing is not in any way looking to dismantle that. I believe that should still go ahead, and that's not my intent at all. Dixon Park is currently a contaminated site classified as remediated restricted use under the Contaminated Sites Act of 2003, and I believe 5 contaminated site investigations were completed within the study area from 2008 to 2017. None of that information was considered by the Heritage Study, whilst the Heritage Study considered development in the area through the 1970s and 80s and 90s. It references photo aerial imagery from 65, 85 and 95, while not including the full setting of the site. I think it's important that we include the full site history in our heritage study and acknowledge what has been done, And I think there are two issues of the heritage and of the contamination of the site that need to be addressed. And one can be remediated whilst the other is looked upon favourably, and hopefully a Section 18 is granted. Again, this is not to discredit the application under the Aboriginal Heritage Act at all.
Thank you, Councillor Weidenbach. I'll just ask for the voting button to be presented, please. Declare it carried 5-3. Thank you. Declare it carried 6-3. Thank you. That is the alternative. Moving through to agenda item 17.2, multiple dog application for /39 Peppermint Gardens, Auburn Grove. And we have a declaration of a proximity interest from the Deputy Mayor. So at this point, we'll ask the Deputy Mayor to leave the council chamber while I read out the declaration. Addressed to the Chief Executive Officer, the particular agenda item 17.2, multiple dog application for /39 Peppermint Gardens, Auburn Grove, type of interest, proximity interest pursuant to Section 5.60B of the Local Government Act 1995. The nature of the interest being I live in the same unit strata complex as the application listed in this item, and I am a member of the Corporate Executive Committee, signed Deputy Mayor Kirkwood. Thank you. So Deputy Mayor's left the council chamber. Ask someone to move the recommendation. Councillor de Blanche, thank you. Seconded Councillor Stone. Is there any discussion or debate on this item? Anyone wishes to speak against it? Question, Councillor Siparovic, thank you.
With our requirements limiting the amount of dogs that a person can have on a property, does that include like puppies?
Thank you, Councillor Siparovic. Mr. Green, thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. Under the age of 3 months only, every dog over the age of 3 months must be registered. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Green. Any further questions? Anyone wishing to speak against? If not, I'll ask for the voting button to be presented. Thank you. Declare it carried 7-1. Thank you. Can we ask for the Deputy Mayor to return to Council Chambers? Thank you. Deputy Mayor Kirkwood, in your absence, the officer's recommendation was voted through 7-1. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we're moving through to agenda item 17.3, the Building Construction Services Community Centre at Treby Estate, RFT 28-2020. And we have a declaration from Councillor Allen, addressed to the Chief Executive Officer, for the ordinary council meeting 11th of February 2021, in this particular agenda item 17.3, and the type of interest is an impartiality interest pursuant to Regulation 11, Local Government, in brackets, Rules of Conduct, close of brackets, Regulation 2007. The nature of the interest being, I am State Manager of Equifax, the organisation Council sought financial viability reports to assist Council in its final determination of selecting a preferred tenderer, signed Councillor Allen. So do we have someone to move this particular item? Councillor Stone, thank you, seconded. Councillor Eva, thank you. Is there any discussion or debate on this one? Anyone wishing to speak against? Questions? If not, I'll call for the voting button, please. I declare that carried unanimously. Thank you. Moving through to agenda item 20. Councillor Stone, do you have a notice of motion given to be given at the meeting?
Do you want that tonight or
no? Okay, thank you.
My bad.
That's all right. Okay, so we're moving through to agenda item 22.3, which I've declared an impartiality interest in, and I'll just read that. Address to the Chief Executive Officer and regarding to tonight's agenda, ordinary council meeting of the 11th of February. Agenda item 22.3, activities at the Manning Park, Azalea Leigh Homestead Museum. The type of interest is an impartiality interest pursuant to Regulation 11, Local Government Rules of Conduct, close of brackets, Regulation 2007. The nature of the interest being, I'm a member of the Historical Society of Coburn. So we have Councillor Tablant, an alternative. Thank you.
The Council, one, received the report commissioned by the City of Coburn on matters related to the operation of the Azalea Leigh Museum, and two, note the recommendations contained therein will be administered under the direction of the Chief Executive Officer.
Thank you, Councillor Tablant. Do we have a seconder for that? Councillor Eva, thank you. And Councillor Tablant, your reason, thank you.
One, to clarify that the purpose of the report is to provide the information that was requested by the Council decision of 12 November 2020. And two, note for the avoidance of any doubt that it is the statutory function of the CEO to be responsible for the direction of any recommendations related to staff.
Thank you, Councillor Tablant. Anyone wish to speak against the alternative? Questions? Opportunity, Councillor Tablant, to close if you wish. No? Okay, I'll ask for the voting button. Thank you. I declare that carried unanimously. Thank you. Just moving through to agenda item 25, which is a resolution of compliance. Could we have someone move that way, please? Councillor Cork, thank you. Councillor Stone seconded it. Thank you. Any discussion, debate? If not, we'll call for the voting button, please. We just have 7 votes at the moment. There's 2 outstanding. Can we just, everyone check? Get in there, 8. Just recheck, please. No? No? Declare it carried unanimously, thank you. Press the 85 times. Ladies and gentlemen, that brings us to the closure of tonight's meeting. I thank you for your attendance and participation. Formally close the meeting, time being 4 minutes past 8 p.m. Thank you.